Question of whether it's legal for a community to discriminate on the basis of race, culture, and religion.
My name is Jaqui Gradwell. I'm a Blanca South Africana.
I was on the internet looking for cult communities in South Africa, and I came across the Eden Project. It caught my attention because of how close it is to me here in the Eastern Cape, and it started fairly recently.
Projek Eden is gebaseer op 'n baie onbeginsel wat bepaal kom uit die boere daar. Ek gaan dit net noem nuwe kolonisme. Dit beteken vat jou familie, jy vat jou besittings, jy gaan na een nieuwe plek, waar daar nie een zwart man is, wat jy heel tyd oor jou skouer moet kyk en wonder wanneer gaan jy beroof word.
The Eden Project was started by Jaqui Gradwell last year. The project is a self-sustaining, whites-only community, so you can't be a part of it if you're not Afrikaans, Christian or white.
The Eden Project is about 20 kilometers outside of a small town in the Karoo called Willowmore. There's been a lot of media hype about the project, but less people actually supporting it.
Jaqui Gradwell, who started the project, is afraid of a white Afrikaans race being murdered and mutilated by black people.
We've heard mixed reports about the development of the Eden, so Collette and I will be going to Willowmore to find out what's actually happening there.
I grew up in Boksburg, which is a really small town near Joburg, and it's a mostly white Afrikaans area. I identify as a black coloured female because my father was coloured and my mum's black. So being brought up in a strong Christian mixed race family, I learned how to speak both Afrikaans and Zulu, and to immerse myself into both of those cultures.
I grew up in an English-Italian family in a mostly Zulu area on a farm in KZN. Literally the only Afrikaans people I knew were the Afrikaans teachers at school. The language seemed so irrelevant to me, like I didn't even know where Afrikaans people came from. The irony is that even though Collette has the characteristics to be part of the Eden, such as being Christian and Afrikaans speaking, she wouldn't be allowed into the Eden.
And Tess, who doesn't believe in God and doesn't speak Afrikaans, would be more accepted into that space just because she's white. Beyond our personal reasons for going on this trip, what the members of the Eden Project are actually doing is illegal.
So let's say that Jaqui has bought a farm with the intentions to sell off plots to white Afrikaans families. He can't subdivide the farmland into plots to sell like he promises to his followers. He can give you the right to live on his farm, but it's illegal for him to actually give someone ownership of a plot, even if they've paid for it.
So we pretty much don't know what to expect from this journey, but we're going anyway.
So it's ready. Hey, what's up?
We've arrived in Willowmore and it feels like we've been sent back 50 years in time. We go into the township to speak to some locals to get a sense of how they feel about this racist project being in their town.
Come. ons dorp was baie klein. Hy sê PE en so wat, verskillende. Want dis nou al area en ons was ons Mandela Square is ons waar die breinmense bly. Die skullets in die dorp is whiteies, amper soos die bedoel jy nou. Nee.
Kijk eens aan mensen spoortrap en trap je moet voor hem toe. Mm. En daar ja, voorkom, dan heb je die ding wat je gaat doen, wat je mee gaan klaarkomen. Ons het moest voor hem toe gegaan voor die een Zuid-Afrika. Dus ons één Zuid-Afrika, wit, brein, zwart, kreel, groen, ons is net één ding. Nou maak ons weer groepen. Die groepen laat ons nou terug verlang, want die tijd van die apartheid het ons moest groepen gehad.
Ah nee, ek sal baie ongelukkig, ek sal nie met dit saamstem nie, ek sal baie ongelukkig voel, want ons is te min mense om nog apartheid te stig in Willowmore.
That way of apartheid, besie bulawa kalok nati. Besie nga bulawa? Besie bulawa. Yabon, sa kobo zeka, kama bulu. And na ikabiko right nangok lento, sebe ibuisele mfango. Zangi pele mo se aparte kakati kakati. Basi petwa nga lama pulu. Titikiwe. Sitikiwe. Sito sonke.
We're doing this diary together today.
The community is pretty segregated itself. So there really is a hectic distinction between the colored area and the so-called black speaking area. Mm-hmm. The people within the black area or the black township area don't understand why they think that way, which makes sense because
what do you mean by that? Yeah,
by when we ask that woman the question of explaining that Jackie's creating the Eden because he believes that black people are going to kill white Afrikaans or commit genocide in the white Afrikaans race.
Yeah.
And when we asked her that question, she was like, they did the exact same thing and we're currently living in townships doing nothing about what they did to us.
Yes, yeah. So 25th, that's fine.
We're on our way to meet Willem Swanepoel, the person who may or may have not sold the farm to Jaqui. We've been trying to organize an interview with Willem for weeks now and we're finally meeting him to find out what really happened to the Eden.
Well, basically, I put my farm on the market for selling, and then Rawson Properties came to me and told me for a meeting that they've got for people that are interested in buying the farm. And then I had the people coming to look at the farm, and that was when the Eden Projek started. It took them, I think, a month, 3 weeks to a month, to set out all these perimeters on the farm, on a GPS, on the map. So that when you're buying your property, you know exactly where the property is. And it's marked out on my farm also with white rocks that was painted and marked. So if you would be buying a property of 1,000 hectares, and you were paying 10,000 foot, it was marked number one, he could bring you to number one because it's already marked. So there was a lot of people that came to the farm, meaning some weekends there was like 10, 12 people coming to look at the farm from Potchefstroom, Klerksdorp, you name the places they were here, from Natal. The people came looking here. It wasn't the hundreds that he was talking about, but it was like 10, 12, 15 people. But yeah, at the end of the day, the deposit was never paid. The 100,000 rand that we originally just put pressure up them to see if something's going to pop out, nothing ever originated from, you know, money that was paid in. The main object for this farm was water for them. And ironically or sarcastically said, at the end of the day, this whole deal fell through because there's no water on this farm. So that was, for me, a bit of a sour fruit, saying that this is the Eden, and that's where the name started going. They said this was the Garden of Eden for them, because there's enough water there, the property is big enough for them, you've got different diversities here on the farm. So yes, everything was running well for them when they was busy marketing, and the moment that they didn't have the money, then there was all the water just dried up.
A few days later, after our interview with Willem, he calls and tells us that Jaqui has moved the Eden Projek to Ladysmith, which is a town about 200 kilometers from Willowmore. After our initial shock, he also said that Jackie's in Ladysmith prison. So we call the correctional services there to find out if the allegation about his arrest is true.
Hi, Captain. My name is Collette Prince.
Hi, ma'am. How are you?
I'm fine, thanks. And yourself?
No complaints, ma'am.
I just wanted to ask about an arrest made of Jaqui Gradwell.
Yeah.
And if there's any information you'd be able to disclose about his arrest?
Ma'am, the only information we have at this stage is, yes, he was arrested in Ladysmith. He didn't plea on any charges in court. He's in prison at this stage, and the bail application will follow on the 28th of June.
Jaqui has moved the Eden Project to Ladysmith, and he's in prison there. So without hesitating, we packed up our things and now we're on our way to Ladysmith. We have no idea why Jackie's in jail, and we're wondering if it has anything to do with the Eden Project. We will find out pretty soon because his bail hearing is tomorrow.
Look at this cute little truck. Ross?
This is the place here. Here it says danger.
Exactly. Good morning, Willem. How are you?
All right, and you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Are you in Ladysmith?
Yes, we are. We're currently like waiting outside the court's magistrate, or the magistrate's court.
Yeah?
Yeah, and we're just waiting for Jackie's bail hearing, but the truck that's bringing in the inmates hasn't arrived yet.
The next thing that you must do is you must get hold of his ex-wife that stays in America.
Okay.
Because apparently there's warrants of arrest for him in America in three different or five different provinces. States.
Okay, no problem.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye.
There's a police car.
Oh my god, Tess, don't do that.
That's where Jaqui is. Focus is shit. Should we? I think let's try to get inside so we can start setting up.
I'm gonna set up my. I'm gonna set up the mic.
Yes. Cool.
Because we can't go inside and film.
Jaqui got arrested for having 25 grams of marijuana and an illegal firearm on him. In court, the judge said that his bail is postponed and a further investigation is taking place.
But things were a bit dodgy and suspicious before we even got in. Mm. I was still thinking that we were never going to see him.
And yeah. Just seeing him, I felt like disgusted inside.
He looked frail. He looked
skinny, like his cheekbones. Yeah, he had no stature. And his hair was overgrown and his beard
it
was
looked
like,
a mane. No, it was like a mane. He looked like a lion. Yeah. And then looking dead into his eyes.
He has a very, very intense stare. It was just like straight at you.
As we reflect about Jaqui's bail hearing and learning nothing about the Eden, we remember Willem telling us to find Jaqui's ex-wife. We have no idea where to start or what she can tell us about the project. So like any normal person, we go on Facebook and we found nothing. We keep looking and we found a site called Ancestry and came across someone by the name of Rose Stiles who was married to Jaqui. So we sent her a message. Is she going to reply? And is this actually the right person?
Collette, Rose replied.
His ex-wife?
No. They're still married.
What?
Yes.
What?
Yeah, she says, I am his wife. I married him in 2002. And I've never divorced him. Yes. I know he's married to a woman called Erizia. I know her. He will not be out of jail next week on bail, and if he is, he will run and you won't have to worry about your meeting. And then she says, I'll be happy to help you.
Wait. So she's fine with her current husband being with someone else. Do you think Arisa's the
one? I think she wants to divorce him, but he ran away before
they were able to do
yeah,
so.
Yeah, definitely.
Mm. And that's probably why he can't marry.
And she knows. She knows there's something. She knows why.
He'll run, or why he's on the run.
Yeah, she knows.
Just makes it trying to ask her. Thank you so much for replying back to us so promptly.
Is it possible we can call you? Because she might be in the States, hey?
Yeah, if she's in the States, I'm not using my A-time to do that, hey?
So, we end up using Colette's airtime to speak to Rose in the States. What skeletons could she reveal about Jackie's past? We pull over on our way back to Willowmore to speak to her. Okay, I'm going to call Rose Stiles now. Jackie's wife in America.
Hi.
Hi, this is Tess speaking.
Is this Teresa?
Yes, this is Teresa, yeah. Sorry, Tess is my nickname.
Oh, Tess is your nickname? Okay.
Yeah. So, our first question that we wanted to ask you is, how did you meet Jaqui?
I met him in September of 98 in Merced River RV Park in California. I was 15 then, and he had just turned 37. I was his sixth wife.
Wow. That's quite an age gap, hey?
Yeah, it is. He's like a wolf in sheep's clothing. He can bend his personality to fit any situation and make any group of people like him. He never talked to me about Eden. It was never a long life dream of his. He hated the Afrikaans language and the people. The religion that he stood for, he couldn't stand. I think they're stupid to follow somebody so blindly just because they say they're that he's a man of God. It's all a bunch of shit. It's just a bunch of shit. It's by a cock, then.
Okay.
By a cock. You know, I've spoke to people, how long did you know Jaqui? Yeah, we knew him for 3 months, so we knew him fairly well. I was like, oh, really? You knew him for 3 months.
Yeah.
And you just gave him your life savings because he said, God, Father has touched me and told me this is where we need to go. You know, it's
insane.
Not a good one.
Yeah. Do you know if he has any criminal records there in America or...
I know of a few things here in America. He was arrested because he violated a restraining order from his wife that he married before me. While he was with me, he was charged with shoplifting and then a lewd act with a minor, but they released him.
So they didn't have enough evidence for the lewd act?
That's right.
Okay. Wow, that's quite a lot to take in.
If you guys can think of any other questions, I'm always free for you.
Okay.
You guys have a nice day.
You too.
Bye.
This is the trick. All the small pieces are at the back, and I only figured out that now.
I think our biggest breakthrough today was definitely getting in contact with Jaqui's wife, Rose. She was able to really put a lot of things together for us, which, and not all of them we can count as absolutely true, but she did connect a lot of
the dots. She stated that she met Jaqui when she was 15 and Jaqui was 37. So when she said that, it kind of put two and two together.
But we came here to find out more about the Eden, and the whole reason we got into Jaqui is to find out about the Eden.
Just when we thought we'd reached the end of our journey, because Jaqui's in jail and we don't know where the Eden is anymore, we hit a breakthrough by contacting someone who left the Eden when it moved to Ladysmith. He is willing to speak to us, on the condition that he's kept anonymous.
I'm going to tell you everything around the Eden Project, but there's some things that I can't tell you, okay? I won't actually, because it's too sensitive. I picked up something that was wrong while I was staying here, and I did pay in my money while I was still in front of Bell Park. Everybody just started to get agitated with him because he doesn't get anywhere. He was trying to con people. That's it. No other way. And when he started to run around and look for other farms, that's when I withdrew my money.
Did he give you all your money
back? Yeah, he gave me my money back. But it was a little bit. I didn't pay any lot. But he was actually planning on the people who's paying on the big bucks. This guy, he needs to be in jail. And he needs to stay there.
Okay, bye. So there's just been an article published about Jaqui and the Eden, and they're talking about his criminal record and about Rhodes and his son who hates him. So I think we should just go buy this newspaper and see what it says. So it's Watts only enclave, leaders shady past by the Weekend Post. The article says that Jaqui actually had enough money to pay the deposit on the farm in Willowmore, but he never paid it. It also says that he has a history of criminal records from shoplifting to owning illegal firearms. They also speak about Rose Styles and that Jaqui changed his name from Johan Quibus Pretorius to Jaqui Gradwell. And lastly, that he's a heartless man who tricked many people into uprooting their lives by scamming them to buy into the Eden Project.
It's like everything we knew, the whole week just solidifying all the information that we know.
We came on this journey thinking that we were gonna find the Eden and confront this racist Afrikaans group. Well, we didn't.
We still don't understand why this group is scared and why they're keeping people out because of their race.
Was it ever about creating a safe community for Afrikaans Christians? Or is Jaqui simply a con artist and a criminal?
At the end of this film, it felt like we were on a wild goose chase trying to find Jaqui and the Eden. But honestly, it was a huge relief to actually not encounter a racist Afrikaans group.
Strangely enough, I started to feel bad for the people who were scammed by Jaqui. And then I remember how backward and racist the project is.
It's pretty ironic how Jaqui manipulated some white Afrikaans people using their fears, when those people actually should have been afraid of him.
My name is Jaqui Gradwell. You're the swart man. What's the toekomst bid hier in land, zoals hij vandaag gestaan?